Good morning. Hey. Would you all stand to your feet? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, right now we give this time to you. Lord, I pray that in this very moment that we would let everything that has been concerning us, all of the things that distract us, that we lay those things aside right now, and we put our focus completely and totally on you, Lord Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Do you feel the world is broken?
We do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen?
We do.
Do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made new?
We do.
Is all creation groaning?
It is.
Is a new creation coming?
It is.
Is the glory of the Lord to be light within our midst? Good that we remind ourselves of this.
It is. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The slave.
Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this?
He is.
Does the Father truly love us? Does the Spirit move among us?
He does.
And is Jesus our Messiah? Hold forever those he loves.
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us?
He does.
Is anyone worthy?
Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah will conquer the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died.
Why don't you have a seat as we recoup from that awesome worship? Yeah, y'all can sit down too if you want. Josh is a goofball. All our worship leaders are goofballs, aren't they? Worship leader. Anyway, all right. Hold on, I have notes. Now, just so I don't forget anything. Tonight, we are meeting tonight. Tonight's my favorite lesson. It's Blessed Are the Merciful. And so please come to that tonight at 6 p.m. The rain should have let up by then, so there won't be any excuse. We'll be meeting in the BRB room, and we will be digging into the Bible. There we go. Tickets for Little Mermaid are on sale. $10, right? Till Wednesday. If you don't buy before Wednesday, you got to pay an extra $2 a piece. So get them today. There's lots of people in this room participating in the play and lots of people selling tickets. So you won't have any trouble getting tickets for that. That is next Friday. That's just... Everybody has tickets. So if you need a ticket, get a ticket. All right, that's 5 days from now. Don't miss it. The star of that show is our very own Kennebeth. And not that much of a smaller role is my daughter, Helen. Oh, yeah, and Cassidy's in it too. All right. And Micah and Josh and everybody, yeah. All right. Who cares? Helen's in it. Did y'all get that part? Helen's in it. Okay. Now, August the 18th, I really need you to be in prayer about this. August the 18th, 2 weeks away, be in prayer. That's our commitment Sunday. That's when we're going to set up tables in there. If you are going to lead an H2H group, be praying about your curriculum. Be thinking about that. Get with me so I can get you a table set up in there, or Pastor Mike, and we'll make sure that you have a table set up for your H2H group, and be praying about what time. If you're going to be flexible on time and seeing who signs up, that's okay. But be praying about where you're going to meet, what time you're going to meet, all of those things. Also be praying about what you're going to commit to as far as we need volunteers. So that's going to be the same Sunday. So we're going to need volunteers for Five Star Kids. We need volunteers for the nursery. We need volunteers for Next Up, the youth program. So be praying about your commitment for the fall. There is, and also, oh, yeah, and then with the launch will be that week will be the beginning of school, and then the next week is when we'll start. So we won't start everything the same week the school starts. So the 28th will be the week that we actually start the H2H groups. But the 18th is when you need to commit. Also, if you didn't go or did go, either one, we created a shared photo album of our trip to Colorado, and we put that out there, and I posted it on Facebook, so you can just go to the church Facebook site and look, and you'll see the little link there, and you can go look at all of the beautiful pictures and goofy pictures and crazy pictures and all the fun that we had. Those are out there on the web, and that's all I have, I do believe. Now, we're going to take what we call a BRB, which is a little 7-minute break to get coffee, use the restroom, get ourselves collected, get the kids over to Five Star Kids. We have Five Star Kids this morning. All right, in the gym. All right. So if you have kids, send them over to Five Star Kids in the gym, and they'll have fun with that. Also, this is an opportunity for you to give. The tables are set up in all the corners, four corners, for you to give your tithes and offerings. Please do that prayerfully. And also communion is available for you. Oh, we're doing corporate communion today. I forget what Sunday it is. Okay. All right. Well, let's pray, and then we'll dismiss to BRB. Lord, thank you so much for the opportunity to come to your house and worship, to lay down our burdens, to not be conformed to this world, but to reunite with our brothers and sisters here in corporate worship, and just renew our minds to you, Father. Thank you so much. Also, we ask for your blessing on all those that will be giving their tithes and their offerings here in the next few minutes. We pray your blessings on those families and the leaders of those families, Father. Give them wisdom and discernment, and bless their finances, Father. We pray also that you will just be with us as we prepare to commit to small groups in the fall, and how important those are, and how many great relationships get developed in those little small groups. So we just pray your hand be upon that as people plan to prepare for that. And we just pray that as we take communion, we're going to take communion at the end, so we won't pray about that right now. We'll pray about it later. All right. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord? Man, that was some good worship. Thank you guys very much for that. And thank you. And when I say thank you guys, I'm not just talking about those who led. I'm talking about those of you who worshiped. It takes all of us corporately to just, put our focus on Jesus. And so I appreciate you guys doing that. It's a very special time when we get to worship the Lord together. Man, it's been a busy few weeks, and the last days of summer, as far as the, I already get sad faces from some of the students, the last days of summer and summer vacations and all that, and there's something wonderful about the kind of the chaos and pandemonium of the summer months, but also it's nice to kind of focus on that fall season when kind of the family comes back home and we all begin to get on track for the next course of the year. So let's just pray together. Let's start out that way and before we get into the Word here. Father God, we pray that you would prepare our hearts right now. We thank you for your presence in this place, Lord. We know that we don't have to beg you to come. Your Word promises us that where two or three are gathered, you're there in our midst, Lord Jesus, and we know the Holy Spirit dwells inside of us. So you are never far away, and for that I am so thankful. Lord, I pray that right now we would put our focus on you and on your Word, and that we would allow it, Lord God, to truly transform us and change our lives, that this would not be something that we do out of just ceremonial purposes, Lord, or punching the clock for Jesus or scoring points, Lord, but this would truly be a time that we would enjoy one another, the body of Christ, our brothers and sisters, and that we would worship you in spirit and truth. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we're talking about the blood covenant, and we're going to talk more this week about how it pertains to the new covenant. And there's a couple of scriptures I want to point out to you. But before we do that, I want to go ahead and I want to review the first several steps of the process of this ceremony. Now remember, these two patriarchs or representatives of the two families would come together in an open field in this ancient ceremony that has been around from the very beginning, okay? And they would bind themselves together in identity, in assets, all the things that they needed to survive. It was a life or death thing, and they helped one another survive. Well, God cut a covenant with Abraham, and through this process, we see the language all throughout Scripture unfold as we read. And so when I'm pointing out the new covenant, I'm trying to point out the process of the blood covenant and how the writers of the New Testament referenced that blood covenant that God cut with Abram, okay? So in Hebrews chapter 7, verse 22, we first have to understand that that old covenant is passed away and Jesus fulfilled it to a T, and he offers us a new and better covenant. And I don't want you to take my word for it. I want you to take the word of God's word for it, okay? So Hebrews chapter 7, verse 22, so much the more also Jesus has become the guarantee of a better covenant. I don't think I have to explain that to you. You know what the word guarantee means, don't you? Okay? And then, of course, we have Hebrews chapter 8, verse 6. But now he has obtained a more excellent ministry by as much as he is also the mediator of a better covenant, which has been enacted on better promises. So we have this promise from God that not only was the old covenant fulfilled, but now we have a better covenant with God, Almighty God, and Christ Himself is the mediator. It was not based on anything you and I can do, but rather it's all resting upon the shoulders of Jesus Christ and the work that He has already accomplished. And that's why when He said, "It is finished," that statement was so powerful. Because there's nothing left for you and I to do, okay? Now, there are ways that we reflect Him and we reflect the freedom of the covenant, and we'll get into that. But let's go through those first steps real quick. I know I switched it up on you a little bit, Jeff. But so the first step, as they would gather together in this field,
would be the exchange of robes, okay? And again, the two patriarchs, their identity and how people recognized them outwardly was their robe. And so they would exchange robes, and that would tell everybody, I'm in covenant with this person. The second step is going to be the exchange of belts. This was an exchange of strength or an exchange of assets, okay? And the third step in the process was the exchange of weapon. And the exchange of weapon was signifying that whoever comes against you as an enemy, they're coming against me too. So now, this is one thing when you're talking about families, but when you're talking about being in covenant with Almighty God, it changes tremendously. Because if you have an enemy coming against you, right, the Lord is my light and my salvation, whom shall I fear? Of whom shall I be afraid? You are in covenant with Almighty God. There is nothing that the enemy can throw at you that can take you away from God or that he can't protect you from. That's a wonderful promise. And that's what the exchange of weapons was all about. The fourth step in the process was the blood sacrifice. And we talked about that a few minutes ago. And these were the animals that were cut in two, and they were butterflied open, and the blood was sprinkled all over on the ground. And this basically was a sealing the covenant with the blood, saying, if I break this covenant with you, let this be done to me. Let me be destroyed. Let me be bruised and broken and torn to pieces if I break this covenant with you. The fifth step in the process was the walk of death. So these two men who were facing one another would do a figure eight, which is the sign of infinity, meaning this is an everlasting covenant. As long as we're alive, this covenant is enacted. And sometimes they would even say, even if I die, even if the patriarch dies, these two families are still in covenant with one another. And God offered the same thing as well. The sixth step in the process is the mark on the body. It's called, they called it the striking of hands, and we're going to talk about that today. The seventh step was the, I'm reading it off the thing up there, so the seventh step is the pronouncement of blessing and curses. We're going to talk about that today as well, and this was simply stating that because I'm in a covenant with your family and you're in a covenant with me, these are all the blessings that come with this, and if you break it, these are all the curses that come along with this. And then the eighth step, which we're also going to cover today, is the covenant meal. And this is a meal that the two would sit down at a table together with the representative families behind them as witnesses, and they would partake in this covenant meal together. And it actually bears such resemblance and is what Jesus was referencing the night he did the Lord's Supper. He was actually saying, this is the new covenant. So when you see this covenant language, it really just opens the Word of God up, and you begin to see things in a new light, that it didn't just start with Jesus, but this was God fulfilling something for the body of Christ and for his people, Israel, that he started way back then when he cut a covenant with Abram. All right, so with that being said, the sixth step in the process, the mark on the body, or the striking of hands. Now, what you need to remember is that in their culture, the hands included the wrist area, okay? So they would make an incision in the wrist, both men, and they would put their hands together. They would bind their hands together and wrap a strap around it and mingle their blood, okay? Not sanitary these days, but probably not back then either, but that was part of the process. They would mingle their blood, and that was called the striking of hands. The word covenant actually means to cut, okay? And that's why when we use the word often in America as making a deal or cutting a deal, we are cutting a deal with someone. We are cutting a covenant with someone, only we have different parameters and different things that we use in our modern society, okay? So the two representatives, again, would mingle their blood. Now, in some primitive cultures, I've mentioned this before, but it's, I think, worthy of repeating. They would use some sort of an abrasive substance or a dye or something, and they would rub that dye in the wound, okay? Later on, they used gunpowder. They would rub that in the wound, and as that wound would heal up, it would leave a tattoo of sorts or a more visible mark, okay? And so it is said that our custom of waving of hands comes from the striking of hands and showing that mark when you're walking by another family or possibly someone in the wilderness at that time, and you would walk by and you would hold up your hand and show them, I'm in covenant with someone else. Don't mess with me. I'm in covenant. If you do something to us, you're going to have to deal with the people that we're in covenant with, okay? So it would darken the area underneath the scar and make that more pronounced. It would be a permanent mark on the body. Now, in the Old Covenant, the mark on the body that symbolized God's covenant with Abraham and his descendants, we talked about this a few weeks ago, he wanted them to have a mark on their body that separated them from everybody else. And remember, David talked about it when he fought Goliath. He called him the uncircumcised Philistine. And the mark on their body that they took was circumcision, okay? And that's what set them apart. And the reason it was that part of the body was because that represented their lineage and their son and their son's son and so on and all their family. And that was an everlasting mark to show that they were a set apart group of people in the grand scheme of things, okay? Now, in the new and better covenant, and that's what I want you to understand as we read through this, in the new and better covenant, Paul tells us that the mark of circumcision is on the heart, okay? In Romans 2, 28 and 29, Romans 2, 28 and 29, here's what it says, "For he is not a Jew who is one outwardly, nor is circumcision that which is outward in the flesh." So he's saying that circumcision thing was negated as far as the covenant with God is concerned. But he is a Jew who is one inwardly, and circumcision is that which is of the heart by the Spirit. So it's in the power of the Spirit, a change of the heart, not by the letter of the law, and his praise is not from men, but from God. So as I point out a few things about this verse, it is by the power of the Spirit that your life is transformed. You cannot do it yourself. You simply believe God, believe His Word, and submit yourself to Him. And as you do that, the Holy Spirit and the power of the Spirit will change you, and you will be circumcised in your heart. You will be changed and become a different person, okay? It's interesting also that it says that His praise is not from men, but from God. It would be very difficult for us to live a life of circumcision of the heart, of a changed life, a truly changed life, if we are too concerned with what other people think. And we're too concerned about gathering praise from other men, okay? We have to be concerned. We have to hunger and thirst for praise from God, that it would be His blessing on our life, that it would be Him moving in our life. And that's what that outward, true, genuine change comes when we submit to Him. So how did God Himself fulfill His part of the covenant in the new covenant? What was the mark that He took on His body? Well, obviously, we see that fulfilled in Jesus once again. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24, it says, "And He Himself bore our sins in His body on the cross so that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. For by His wounds you were healed." So it's referencing His wounds, and it's not even referencing a physical healing, which we often use that scripture here, "by His stripes we are healed," talking about a physical healing. But what it's referencing here, if we allow the Bible to interpret the Bible, He's saying that He, by His wounds we were healed in the manner of that we have the power to die to sin and live in righteousness, the righteousness of Christ. It was the work that He did, His righteousness, because He is our mediator. We can put our trust fully in Him and not have to worry about the times that we stumble and fall. We don't have to flog ourselves, okay, and beat ourselves up and live in perpetual guilt and condemnation. We don't need that. That is not owed to us because Christ paid for it all on the cross, okay? So because of those wounds, He took those wounds, I believe, eternally, that when we get to heaven, as we see later on in Revelation, He still has the scars in His hands and His feet and the hollow in His side. He will be marked by those wounds forever and ever and ever. And that's powerful. Why? Because He was referencing the fulfillment of the blood covenant. In John chapter 20, verse 26, it says, after 8 days, his disciples were again inside and Thomas with them, and Jesus came, and the doors were shut, and he stood in their midst and said, peace be with you. And then he said to Thomas, reach here with your finger and see my hands, and reach here with your hand and put it into my side, into this wound in my side, and do not be unbelieving, but believing. He took those marks, and those are the proof and the evidence that he fulfilled everything that needed to be fulfilled, and all you have to do is not be unbelieving, but be believing. Just believe him. It's interesting to note the covenant language that Paul uses in Galatians chapter 6, verses 14 through 17. Galatians 6, verses 14 through 17. But may it never be that I would boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world, for neither is circumcision anything nor uncircumcision. So again, he's referencing the original blood covenant by referencing circumcision. He says, but a new creation. A new creation. And those who walk by this rule, peace and mercy be upon them and upon Israel of God. From now on, and then Paul makes a personal statement, from now on, let no one cause trouble for me, for I bear on my body the brand marks of Jesus. Now, it's quite possible that Paul, after all the beatings and the persecution, there's even belief that he was actually branded, and he maybe even walked with a limp. Maybe he had scars on his body. He bore the marks of being a follower of Christ in his body. And he says, for I bear on my body the brand marks of Jesus. Visibly, you could see that this man loved Jesus and he had been beaten for it and persecuted for it. Paul, in our modern day, if you think about it, is there anything that sets us apart? How do we bear his mark on our body? How do we bear the mark on our body? How are we set apart from an unbelieving world? Is there something that when people look at us, sets us apart visibly? The scripture has the answer. The mark we bear is to live holy, is to live set apart with a faith-filled, believing heart. People should know when they look at your lives, they should know that you belong to Jesus. That's the mark you bear. That's the mark you bear. When they look at you outwardly and they see you living your life and walking your walk and talking your talk, there should be no confusion about who you belong to. You belong to Jesus, and that is the mark that we bear. The seventh step in the process is the pronouncement of blessings and curses. The two representatives, again, as I mentioned before, would face one another, and they would say something very similar to this as they walked and did the figure eight thing. They would say, so long as you keep the terms of this covenant, blessed shall be when you go out, blessed you shall be when you go in, blessed shall you be when you rise up and when you lay down. Blessed shall be your wife and all of your children. And they would name your, blessed shall be your oxen and your goats and your all that kind of stuff. Okay? And blessed shall be all that you put your hand to. That would be what the two men would say to one another. Basically, anything that you need, anything that you are out of, if you no longer have a supply of, I will be your supply, whether it be food or livestock or gold, no matter what the case, whatever it is, I will bless you. Whatever your need, I will supply it. Okay? And then we see in Philippians 4:19, Paul makes this new covenant statement. He says, and my God will supply all of your needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. Every need that you could possibly have, every need that you can possibly have, it is a promise that he will fulfill it. Now, You may say, well, I want a Rolls Royce. That is not a need. All right, so sometimes we need to change the definition of what our needs actually are. And our need and our supply, I think if we put our focus and our hunger and our thirst rest solely in Jesus and wanting more of Him in our life, then we'll be good with whatever He wants to hand us. Because remember what Jesus said. He said, what father, when his son or daughter asks for a fish, would hand him a serpent? He's going to be good to you, and you can trust Him in that manner. In Romans 8, 16 and 17, it says, the Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, we are heirs also, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ. So if indeed, now it takes an interesting turn here when it's talking about how all the good stuff, that we're heirs, co-heirs with Christ, we're sons and daughters. Indeed, we suffer with Him so that we may also be glorified with Him. So there's this idea of this future fulfillment that as we suffer here on earth because things have not been yet made perfect, there is a day coming in which things will be made perfect and you will be glorified with Him, okay? So the word suffer is not something that we really like too much these days, is it? We don't volunteer ourselves to suffer. But God's Word promises us that as a follower of Christ, there will be suffering involved to some degree. And we're not gluttons for punishment. We don't run out there looking for abuse. There is a purpose, a real purpose in our suffering. Okay? And it has a lot to do with that beating that Paul spoke of, bearing the brand marks of Jesus. It has a lot to do with being persecuted and just dealing with the brokenness of the world. The church, as I often say, is His plan A. You and I, we're it. We're the plan to reach the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I want you to think about something in a different light this morning, okay? This is difficult. And when I've talked about this before, it's caused people to actually leave the church, okay? But the church cannot continuously point to worldly solutions. And by that, I mean legislation and politics and all of the things that in our culture we believe are the answers. Christ is the answer. Jesus is the answer. And the more we point the wrong direction instead of pointing to Him, you cannot legislate morality. You are never going to put a politician in office. Now, I'm not saying we don't do our duty, folks, okay? Don't misunderstand me. We need to do our duty as citizens. But we also need to understand that we are citizens of heaven first. And the one who sits on the throne, he is not shaken by who our governor is or who our state representatives are or who's sitting at the desk in the White House, okay? So just keep in mind, fight the good fight. Live the way you believe and fight for the causes you believe in. But don't ever lose sight of the fact that He sits on the throne and there's nothing that can happen in this earth that He doesn't already know is going to happen. And that's why we can have peace no matter what, okay? I think I chased a rabbit there and now I have to find my place in my notes. But here's something this is what I want to tell you, okay? This is our opportunity in this world. We absorb the anger, the body of Christ, just like Jesus absorbed the blows. We absorb the anger and the hate and the ridicule and the frustration of the world, and we become a part of the solution. It's not going to come any other way than through the blood of Christ. And people who believe that what Jesus said was true, and we live it because we believe it, And by that mark, that outward visible mark of us living our lives for Jesus, the world is changed and transformed with the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is not our job to freak out and act like the sky is falling. We don't lash out in frustration as the body of Christ and kick the can further down the road with greater force and energy to exacerbate and cause more chaos. We say, peace be still. We bring peace into the chaos. That's our job as the body of Christ. As we see these folks in El Paso and these folks in Dayton, Ohio, and we see these things continuously unfold as our world gets dark and it's seemingly more dark, in that darkness is our opportunity to shine even more, to make an even greater difference with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We can't ignore it. But again, the solution is not with more legislation and laws. The solution is in loving people and putting our finger on what's causing it. If you want to use this as an example, you know, when you think about what causes a young man to walk into a place with a loaded weapon and just inadvertently begin shooting people at will with no respecter of age or race or position or whatever, it's just pure unadulterated hate and evil being poured out on humanity. Well, what is the solution for that? It's Jesus. It's the love of God. And until we understand that as the body of Christ and we truly begin to walk in that, bearing His marks, absorbing the blows, absorbing the hate, absorbing all of the frustration of the world out there because they're searching for answers and they can't find it and they feel betrayed and they're going to lash out. But we know the answer, don't we? So let's be the light in the world. Let's be what Jesus called us to be. We get to suffer for Him. We have the honor to suffer for Him and take those blows. We take all of that terrible stuff and we turn it around. We pull it all in, we give it to God, and what we give back to people is the love of Jesus Christ. Amen. The eighth step in the process is the covenant meal. The covenant meal. So these two representatives would sit down at a table facing one another, and they would take this meal together, this covenant meal. And it's not unlike what we see today in our modern wedding ceremonies when the bride and the groom in the reception feed one another cake and they feed one another punch or whatever it is they choose to drink at their wedding. That is a picture of the original blood covenant, okay? But what these two men would do is they wouldn't just feed themselves. Imagine two grown, very manly, bearded men feeding one another. Okay? That's the way it worked. Now, it takes something in a man to just kind of chill to let another man feed you. Okay? All right? At least in my case. So you can imagine what that meant. It was like, I am surrendering here and I'm receiving what you have to give. All right? But they would say to one another, as you are eating this food, you are eating my flesh. You are ingesting my body into yours. Okay? They would give them a drink, and in so doing, they would say, you are taking my life blood into your life blood. My blood into your blood. My DNA becomes your DNA. Again, we see the melding of identities, the two becoming one. And it's a picture of our relationship with Christ. In John 6:48, he says, I am the bread of life. Can you go ahead and just scroll to the next one? I don't have them in my notes. Jesus says, your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. So he's making a point like, that was a miracle. God provided manna, but they still died. Okay? He's making that point on purpose. And he says, but this is a bread which comes down out of heaven so that one may eat of it and not die. He's talking about an eternal covenant. That if you partake in this covenant, that it will change you for eternity. Not just in the here and now, but for eternity. What an amazing promise. Next verse. Is that it? I'm the living bread that came down out of heaven. So he just names it. I'm the one. I'm the bread that came down out of heaven. If anyone eats this bread, he will live forever. And the bread also which I give for the life of the world is my flesh. So he was saying, just as you broke this bread and crushed this bread, I am giving my flesh, my body up to the world to be broken and beaten and pierced and torn apart for the sake of all humanity, the world that I love. The Lord bless... Oh, I'm sorry, that's not it. That's for the end. I was about to read something for the end. That's okay, you're good. So, it's all about this taking this into yourself, into your blood, okay? Becoming one. Jesus was saying, I am your covenant meal. I am living bread for you. I am the life that you need, that true life. You can search for all this cotton candy and all this nasty food that the world has to offer, but I am the bread of life. Only I can offer you the kind of sustenance that you need that will truly fill that hole in you, that deep spiritual hunger that you have. You are taking my life into your life. I will become part of your DNA. I will become your identity. Do you realize what this is all about as we talk about this covenant with Jesus Christ? That he's more than just my homeboy. Jesus is not my homeboy. Jesus is my all in all. He is my identity. He defines me. All that I am is found in Christ alone. Truthfully, without Jesus, you're finished. You're done. You have no hope. You're eating bread that spoils. And although we live in a world that we have good things from God, unless you know his son Jesus, that stuff is like the manna in the wilderness. You're still going to die if you don't believe in the one who came down, the bread that came down from heaven. This truth is reiterated. I'm going to go ahead and ask that we lower the lights, and just for the sake of intimacy with the Lord right now. And I'm going to ask you to get out of your seats and go ahead and come take the communion elements as we take this covenant meal together and we realize what it's truly all about. I'll give you a few minutes to get the elements of communion and then we'll begin again. When you look at this bread and this cup, in light of the covenant, may this be done to me if I break this covenant. God upheld his end of the deal, but you and I did not. Man could not. It was not within our power. So Jesus, fulfilling this covenant, offered himself up, the bread of life, to be broken and crushed and bruised, ridiculed, and he hung on a cross between heaven and earth for all to see on our behalf, on your behalf. And when you take that bread and you crush it between your teeth, you should remember that that is how his body was crushed. It was a part of the covenant, and he did it for you. It should be done in solemn respect and honor of his sacrifice and all that he's done for us. And every drop of blood that he poured out that fell to the earth, it didn't just cover our sin, it wiped it away forever. The Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. You proclaim the thing that brought victory. You proclaim the event that changed each and every one of our lives eternally. Every time we do this together as a family, we remember the price that he paid. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, as we face the darkness in the world, you have called us the light. You have called your church a city on a hill. It can't be hidden. Its light shines in the darkness. And we know, Lord, that as we shine the light, your light, that it also draws ridicule. It draws frustration, persecution. And Lord, we know that we've got brothers and sisters around the globe that face a deeper persecution. There are those today that will likely give their lives for the case, for the gospel of Jesus Christ. But Lord, we in our world, in our society, we just have to deal with the occasional pushback and ridicule. And Lord, I pray that our attitude toward this would that we gladly absorb anything the world throws at us. That we receive it as you received the blows on your body. That we would see it as an opportunity to show your love in a way that no one else can show. That we offer the only answer. Lord, would you show us how to bear your mark on our body, how to be visibly different to a world that is lost and dying and headed for eternal separation from you. Let us be the answer. So, Lord, I pray for every person in this room, whatever it takes. Whatever it takes to get our attention, whatever it takes to let things fall aside that we don't need in our lives, if we need to simplify, Lord, that our hunger and thirst would be set only on you, and that we would truly take seriously the mission that you've given your church. Lord, we pray now as a local body for those families in El Paso and those families in Dayton, Ohio. Lord, there is no way we could imagine the pain that those families are going through this morning. And Lord, there's no way that I can conceive of the pain that it takes to cause someone to go and do something like this to innocent people. So Lord, would you show us how to shine in a way that would bring light in the darkness? We love you, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen. I do want to pray this scripture over you as we leave today, that the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. The more peace and freedom you have, the more peace and freedom you have to offer the world through Christ. God bless you all. Thank you for being a part of this family. We love you.